Welcome. My name is Mark DePue. I'm the Director of Oral History with the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library. Today is Wednesday, February 3rd, 2016, and today is my second session with Mary Ann Koucky. Good afternoon, Mary Ann.
Good afternoon.
It's good to have you here again today. We had quite a session last time, fascinating session about your experiences spending 3 years in a Japanese internment camp in the Philippines at the beginning of the war. Obviously, you went into December of 1941, and we got all the way up through late December of 1944. I think you were transferred from Baguio, which was well north in the island of Luzon, to Manila, specifically to a prison camp in Manila named Bilibid Prison, an old prison camp where they now had Americans and prisoners of war and civilian prisoners, correct?
Right.
What I wanted to start with today, before we get to the point of you finally getting liberated, is to ask a couple more questions about that experience, and specifically, how much contact with the outside world you and your family had. Were there any letters either coming in or going out that you're aware of?
Nothing. I don't remember receiving or hearing my parents say they got a letter. They hoped there could have been some people that got it, but I'm not aware we did.
Okay. What I wanted to do is read a couple things here, because apparently there is at least an attempt, maybe more than one attempt, to get letters in. And this is a letter that was originated Dominican Sisters of Kewaunee, Illinois. So this is obviously something that would have been written for your mother's
Her oldest sister was a nun, Sister Obertus in Kewaunee.
Okay.
So there would be the interest.
And it's addressed to Mr. and Mrs. Sanford Ladic and three daughters, interned by Japanese Baguio internment camp, Baguio, Philippine Islands. And here's the information that's written underneath. And obviously, the family never saw this. And here's why the family never saw it. This communication is returned since the Japanese government has refused delivery of any mail to American prisoners of war and civilian internees held by Japanese unless it complies with all of the following conditions. One, letters must be less than 25 words in length. You can't say much in that.
No.
Two, letters must be typewritten or legibly block printed. Three, subject matter must be strictly personal. No military or political matters or opinions may be included. Four, the name of the internment camp must appear in the forwarding address. And then below that it says, these conditions have been imposed by the Japanese government and not by the U.S. government. So at least there was some attempt to make contact with the family.
Oh, the family's close. They would definitely.
Now, here's the extent of the information they probably were able to receive. And this is from some people who had been exchanged. Some Japanese and allied prisoners had been exchanged somewhere. And then obviously they would be debriefed and try to find out as much as you can. So this is from the Department of the State, Washington, D.C., dated December 9th, 1943. So
That's way back in Camp Holmes.
That's in Camp Holmes, but that's 2 years after you guys have been in prison, before the family knows anything. The MS Gripsholm has recently arrived in New York from the Portuguese India, where the second exchange of American and Japanese nationals took place. The department's representatives aboard the Gripsholm made a special effort during the return voyage to obtain from the persons repatriated information concerning American nationals remaining in the Far East. And that's really all they could possibly do. And here's what it says about your family. Sanford William Ladic, his wife and three daughters, are all in good health at Baguio Camp. Baguio being the Camp Holmes.
Okay.
Mr. Ladic is one of the camp cooks and also runs a small business of his own in camp, the most important item being the handling of meat, which you and I talked about last time.
Yeah.
That is how he's been able to obtain pocket money for himself and his family. Between his business and the kitchen, he keeps extremely busy. The three girls attend the camp grade school. How difficult was it for your family back in the United States, your mom's family especially, not knowing practically anything about what's going on.
Right. No, they just prayed, and that was all you could do, is and talked among themselves. Mind you, there were five girls, my mother's family, and so they were very curious.
I'm sure they did a lot of praying then.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't imagine what it had been like for the family, just worried to death about what was going on with all of you.
I have no idea. That's frustrating, not being able to know the right person to get the right answer. These gals, if there was a way to get a right answer, they would have found it.
A little bit like your mother in that respect?
Yeah, I think there is.
Okay. I'd like to have you then, before we get to the rescue, tell us more about the prison. And we talked a little bit about that last time, but describe the living conditions you had.
In Bilibid.
In Bilibid.
Right. That one was very poor. We were having two meals a day, corn meals, rice. The corn meal, from what I hear later, that the germ of the kernel was eaten by bugs, and so you had, the protein was weevils and the crust of the corn. And there was some indication that they had to grind the corn. And I thought that was something that, pretty sad that you don't have nutrition from the germ of a corn kernel. And so you have just roughage. And I remember myself being so hungry that you'd pull blades of grass. So eventually there was no grass on the ground. It was just mud or dirt. Your body wanted green something. And so we were really being starved by portions. Later I found out that that was purposeful. And the troops of the Japanese had to have their food, so we had remnants.
Did you have a different set of guards at Bilibid than you had in Camp Holmes?
Yes, we were back to the Japanese, and they were tough. You really just obeyed them and didn't argue. Movements around the camp were just from cell to cell. You really didn't have any place to go but your cell.
Did they do morning roll calls?
Yes.
If you did encounter a Japanese, how would you expect it to act when you saw them?
Good morning, Ohio. Good morning. And then move on.
Now you're nodding your head because you were expected to bow?
Yes, we bowed, but the word Ohio is good morning. And so that was my extent of knowledge of the Japanese. I never spoke Japanese.
Some of the pictures I've seen from the war, the Americans were bowing, but they would have their hands along their sides. Is that how you had to do it?
Yes, for roll call.
How far down did you have to bow?
Well, I don't remember it being that strict. I just know that we bowed, and we had a tin plate name tag or number on our, we wore all the time. I was number 143, and so if there's somebody missing, it would show up pretty quickly by not having them in the sequence.
Describe the sleeping quarters that you have.
A cell with bars on it and cots. We could have, before the fire in Manila, have had blankets that we brought from Baguio, but it was very slim, just a blanket or two.
What was the worst part about being in Bilibid prison?
Oh, it was horrendous. Being hungry.
Now, you mentioned earlier, though, the smell as well.
As well, the smell of the Bataan boys being buried there and decaying.
Had those Bataan prisoners been there for a long time before the civilians arrived?
I think so. I never really saw them, but that's where we were told they ended up from Corregidor. And so how big the prison was, I don't know. We were kept in our cells and then in a certain walled area.
And was your mother still with you most of this time in Bilibid?
Yes, she was very sick, but and dying as it came, but time was moving on. They had kind of a place where dysentery people were placed in a cell, and that she was removed to, so we wouldn't get contagion around. She didn't go to Santa Tomas until the Americans came.
Okay. And we talked last time, Santa Tomas is another prison camp area. It used to be a university that's, what, just a couple blocks away?
That's what I understand.
Okay. What rumors were you hearing? This is late in the war. We mentioned last time you were seeing American bombers. Occasionally the area would be bombed itself.
Yes.
What rumors were you all hearing?
Oh, they're coming. They're coming. We're getting there. Yeah. It's exciting, but then there was nothing, and you wait, and then you see another one, and it was sporadic.
Were you hearing any rumors about how the Japanese might react when the Americans came?
No, I don't think we cared, but we were very obedient. We were still doing our things. But we didn't dream that the Japanese would walk out. Nobody knew. The evening that the Americans did come in tanks was the noisiest. You can't believe how noisy tanks are on brick walls and floors. But it was what's coming, and we didn't know what the Japanese would do, so everybody behaved.
Okay. There had been a couple occasions in the Philippines and other places in the empire where the Japanese had slaughtered their prisoners rather than have them being released or taken over.
That's right.
And you didn't know anything about any of those?
We knew that maybe that's where they were headed, was with the nutrition, that they would just slowly kill us by not being starved. But not gruesome like they did with other prisons. We didn't have that.
Yeah, some of the circumstances were horrific.
Yes. We were still in civilization as far as we're not out in the jungle where you get all kinds of sickness. We were in a city with cement.
Okay. So you've already started to tell a little bit about, but describe for me the point when the Americans first got to the camp.
Oh, it was exciting. It was in the evening, and we heard the rumble of the tanks coming and didn't have any idea. And finally, after some people said, those are tanks coming, and they're Americans. I don't know who started that story, but it was exciting. Our guards stayed, and overnight, the next morning, they were gone without a fight in our compound. Now, I don't know if the Filipinos were waiting for them on the other side, but we had a lot of excitement going on. Bombers over us all the time, the B-52s, 100 at a time. It was just all war broke out. Mm. It was exciting, though. MacArthur came in the next day.
Really?
Yes, very quickly, before the assurance that the Japs were removed. But that was most memorable. Everybody started singing America the Beautiful, and it was very emotional.
Did you see McCarthy yourself?
Oh, yes. And he had his wife with him. Came in by tank and white gloves. He was very well dressed, as his wife was. And they didn't get out of the tank. They just came and made an appearance and then left.
Had you heard that he had made that pledge when he left the Philippines back in 1941? I shall return?
Yeah. I heard it later. Yeah. I heard it from the other guards that were around, but we were just glad that he came.
Okay. Now, here's the advantage that several people have written about this experience. And so what I'd like to have you do is read a passage that your father actually wrote about the rescue.
That would be...
And that's this portion right here, Marianne. Okay. And then I'll read what Francis said about the experience. Your cousin Francis.
Oh, because he's in the Army.
He is in the Army, and he was in a unit that helped liberate the camp.
Yes. Rescued around 7 o'clock at night on February 3rd, 1945, we heard heavy firing, and a fellow on the second floor yelled out, "American tanks and soldiers are coming down the street." We did not believe him at first, but then, hell broke loose. We knew that there was something going on outside. It's an emotional time. Everybody was happy. Nobody gave a thought to danger. This was what we had waited for 3 years and 5 weeks. Our prison was surrounded by tanks while Santa Tomas, the soldiers, went right into their camp. Our Jap guards made all the internees on the second floor go down to the first floor. They set up machine guns on the roof and had a good supply of hand grenades. The rest of us lived in cell blocks, were told to go in our cells and remain there. The Japs guarded us closely. At 11 a.m. the next day, the Jap guards took their machine guns, hand grenades, and went out of our section into the section occupied by our soldiers. That was the last we saw of them. We were told they mounted the prison towers and sniped at our troops. We heard the snipers for several days. The first American came out into old Bilibid at night on February 4th. February 5th, a great number came in, and they never saw a happier crowd. The soldiers took their own rations, candy and gum, and passed them out. It was on the 5th that the Japs started burning and blowing up Manila. We watched it from the roof of the building.
Okay, let's hold off for that here for a little bit.
All right. I'm sorry, but it's pretty dramatic.
Looks like that part you remember very well. Even as a 10-year-old little girl, yeah. You remember very well.
Yes, at 82, still remembering. Yeah.
Wow. Well, here's your cousin's version, and remind us the relationship here with your cousin, and this is on your mother's side, right?
Right. His grandmother and my grandmother were sisters.
Okay. This is a letter that Francis Callahan, we've got a picture over here right now of Francis. That's from his unit's yearbook, the 530th Engineer Company, which was a Ponton Bridge Company. And they made bridges. They were in the process, as we start in here, they were building a bridge across the Pasig River, which is just south of the prison. You can see it on this map here. And maybe just a couple miles north, and probably even less than that, are these two prison camps with Bilibid on the left and Santa Tomas on the right here. And those are little brown spots that you see. So here's his letter. "Dear Mother, just found time to write a few lines. I really have plenty to tell you, but time is short. We have been very busy, and I haven't written in quite a while. We arrived in the largest city in the Philippines, and it isn't the place it used to be. It was almost completely burned down. We were just putting up a bridge in the heart of town, and it was plenty tough. We were being constantly shelled by artillery, mortar, and plenty of sniper fire. We completed our mission. I was informed that the Americans had received the American prisoners from the Japs. Curiosity never killed the cat, and I took off to see if I could find out any information concerning my uncle and aunt and their three daughters. From one place to another I went. Now and then sniper fire would fire, but I was certain that I would find someone that had information about my uncle and aunt. I was told by a nice fellow that they were there someplace, and he mentioned when we did the interview that that person was a Filipino who was helping him out. Being a large place, I finally found out that they were in a college nearby. Off again with much faith in finding them. They were guarded by American soldiers, and I finally convinced one of them to let me in. I saw the hires up, and I was told by a friend of Sanford's that he knew him well and called him Sam. I finally was able to see him, and being such a long time since we met, I didn't recognize him. I said, "Francis Callahan from Chicago." Boy, he just hugged me all over. Who was behind him but his three daughters dressed in bright yellow dresses and beautiful blonde hair. He was informed through the Red Cross letters from Kit and a few others that I was in the Philippines, but didn't have the slightest idea he would ever see me again. I talked with him a little over the next 2 hours, and he told me Seal was in the hospital but was getting better. Tickled pink to see me, and I was to see him.
Yeah.
Boy. Incredible stories,
it
isn't
is.
It? Okay. Now, following along here. So you're released. Do you remember that first American food that you tasted?
I couldn't tell you exactly what it was. It was food, and it was not cornmeal. It was wonderful. I can remember the pancakes that the tank corps gave us, but the first food would be the next day. It wasn't during all the shooting. I really don't remember. It was just good food.
What other emotions are you experiencing that time? Can you recall any of that?
Well, trying to taste the butter and the different things staying with the food, it kind of wasn't the best tasting butter I thought of. Canned rations are a little different. But it was good food still.
What was it like seeing American soldiers?
It was wonderful, but you're still with all the combat gear on them and us. You just stare. It's all a new world.
Well, that's the thing. You're very much right in the middle of a combat zone at that time, aren't you?
Yes. Yes. And we knew to duck. We knew to cover our necks if we had to and hit the floor. So we were ready for what we could do.
Mm-hmm. You saw one of the pictures there, just kind of the death and devastation that were laying the street, even when mm-hmm. Francis was going from this bridge where they were working on up to the prison camps, he was seeing some of this. So you're right in the middle of a war zone. Across that river, it's mm-hmm. still Japanese-held territory, and there was a horrendous fight for a couple more weeks, I think at least, in that intramuros area, I think that's how you pronounce it, right in the heart of Manila, close to the ocean itself.
What really hit me was all the bodies floating in the river. The dead were, I couldn't believe, and nobody was respecting whose they were, but I'm suspecting they were mainly Japanese. Lots of bodies.
Were the Japanese also putting the torch to much of the city at the time?
Oh, yes. They burned it. Yeah. It was their protection to fight.
Okay. And I'm sure they had orders that they would fight to the death.
That's right. They would, and they would.
Okay. What I'd like to have you do next is, because you're in the heart of all of this fighting, I know the military, American military, decided to move you, and that's what this next part is here, the move to the shoe factory, and it's continuing on the top of the next page as well.
Okay.
And this is more from your father's recollections.
Yes. It was on the 5th that the Japs started burning and blowing up Manila. We watched it from the roof of our building. I have seen pictures of burning, but they do not come up to the actual thing. That night at 8 o'clock, we were ordered to pack up an overnight bag and what bedding we could carry and go out in the back way. All able-bodied men and women and children had to walk. This was the first chance to see the military prisoners. They had to go out through our section, and most of them were stretcher cases. They were the ones that suffered. Three died that night. They had malaria, dysentery, beriberi. Mrs. Ladic had dysentery, and she was taken out on a stretcher. The three children and I walked 8 blocks. We were all carrying something. We were finally picked up by a jeep and taken to a shoe factory. We all slept on the floor, and the next morning we had our first American meal. The breakfast was bacon and eggs, bread, jam, coffee. While we were lined up, I saw another fellow with some oatmeal. I left my children in line and went down the street and came back with a can of oatmeal with cream and sugar, and we ate that while we were lined up for breakfast. It is hard to describe how good food tastes. The oatmeal was the first in 3 years to have sugar and cream and wheat bread.
Wow. Do you remember that oatmeal?
Yeah. Now that it comes back, yeah.
Right. Okay. What happened, though, once you got to this shoe factory? You weren't there very long, were you?
No. They returned us back to our barracks in Bilibid, and we found everything gone. Whatever we took out originally is all we had left. The Filipinos or whoever ransacked the prison, and so we were left with less.
Were you mad? Were your parents mad at the Filipinos for doing that?
No, it was a shock. And yet, war is war. I can remember being shocked, but never angry. What can you do? It's war.
Okay. There's another incident that occurred not too long after that. I think you stayed there for a few more days, I would believe.
In the prison.
Yeah.
Yes.
And there's another incident, close call for you and not so close for some others.
Yes.
Can you describe that?
We went to bed one, I don't know what date it was, but we went to bed and on our cots, and it seemed like midnight or sometime late, a bomb was dropped on the other side of the wall right next to us and killed our good friend Captain Rogers and his tank corps. The kamikaze was looking for the damage he could do alone, and he did it. He knocked out, I'm not sure if it was 4 or 6 tank corps people, but they were the ones that gave us food through the hole in the wall. The wall being a foot and a half. Somehow I thought it was 3 feet, but I think my father said a foot and a half thick and moved it 3 feet maybe. But the wall was moved, and how lucky we were that the bomb hit that side rather than our side. But it's still sad.
I understand even that your family had had known Captain Rogers even before the war?
That's right. That's what I hear. My mother met him, I believe, as she was coming back on a troop ship.
Oh, after she went back to the United States and right before the war started, yeah, she came back to the Philippines.
Yeah. She wanted to be, she knew there was a war coming. I guess everybody knew it but us. Well, even my father. But she took the last troop ship. And and she says she knew him beforehand. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Well, I wanted to read your father's account of this same incident. This is from a letter to Marge and Bill. Who would that be?
That's my aunt, my mother's sister.
Okay, and her husband.
And her husband.
This was dated February 16th, 1945. Dear Marge and Bill, the Ladics, thank God, they are still alive. We have our closest call yesterday. Francis visited us yesterday afternoon, and he knows how close a call we had. Yesterday morning, the three children and myself were nearly thrown out of bed at 6:15. It's hard to describe just what happened. There was a big flash, and things began to fly. I thought a shell had hit the roof. We all hit the floor and stayed there for a while. It was too dark to see what really happened, and we ran over to the main building in case another shell hit. This is what happened. A Jap plane was looking for our battery and dropped a bomb which hit alongside the wall. Battery would be referring to artillery piece.
Right.
It fell alongside the wall, less than 2 feet away from the wall and directly in front of our cell block. The force of the blast moved the wall a couple of inches and threw pieces of concrete into our cell. And then further down in the letter, I went to the hole in the wall and talked to one of the tank corps. I asked him if anyone was hurt, and he said Captain Rogers and four of his men were killed, also several Filipinos. The captain and men were sleeping alongside the wall when the bomb hit, cut the captain in half. And then farther down, CO returned home yesterday at 11 a.m., just in time for a real treat. We were given frozen fresh beef from Iowa, and I fried them over a charcoal burner, and they were marvelous. The other day, we were given fresh eggs from California. We are being well taken care of and well fed. And from what I know and hearing from other people, people in the kind of starvation conditions you were, it takes a while to get reconditioned to eating this rich food, doesn't it?
Yes, yes, and we were warned. We were warned to go slow and thin out the oatmeal with the milk. You would thin it with water because it'd be too rich otherwise.
Do you remember your mother coming back with you?
Not really. I remember her being gone, but then things started to move. You were really more interested in your next meal than with mother coming back. I don't remember whether she was still sick or weak, but I don't remember the incident.
Was your father, were the girls afraid that she might not survive, that she might not live through this?
We really didn't think she, you just pray. There was some talk that she was 108 pounds, and, you know, at that time, it was just survival. What can you do?
Mm-hmm. Well, I have a letter this time, something that your mother wrote on February 20th, and to one of her relatives back in the States. Finally, in my illness to date, God is sparing me. Shortly after the Army came in, I was in the hospital running a temperature, vomiting, and eliminating blood. One night, this end of town was on fire. Two soldiers put me on a stretcher, drove me in an ambulance to a shoe factory. Everyone finally got there, and we spent the night. Meanwhile, the Filipinos robbed us. Nothing was left. All of the sick had to be taken to Santo Tomas. The rest of my family went back to the prison. I was taken to Santo Tomas University, our Dominican foundation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
My temperature rose to 104, and I was dying amidst shrapnel flying all around me, while Japanese shelled us constantly for a week. Women died beside me daily. I had asked for a priest, but none came. I was about to lose my mind when a Dr. Aaron of New York City came and took an interest in me. He ordered blood and glucose transfusions. With them came life and normalcy. Then I was transferred to Quezon City, which is part of Manila. I picked up enough to get home to my family, though. Even this had a hand of God in it.
Yeah, really.
Well, I guess...
See, all that's a blank to me.
But this is a harrowing experience for anybody to go through. Yeah. Your mother was obviously a very religious woman, and she raised you three girls in that same tradition. Does this kind of experience strengthen your faith and resolve?
Yes.
It does.
It does. There is an end someday.
And again, you don't recall when she actually came back and rejoined the family again?
No, I think that... because there was a month there, February, we were moved to Leyte, and she would have gone, but she still wasn't with us in Leyte.
She still was trying to rebuild her strength, I would
Right, bet. And with either a hospital or something. I don't remember her being with us yet.
Do you remember the trip to Leyte?
Yeah, it was by plane from Manila to Leyte, and on sitting on the plane, no pressure in the plane. I got so sick. I had straw hats on and took it off and just kept vomiting because a plane that's not pressurized, you're sick. I mean. You can't take that altitude. And so my straw hat became my bucket. But then we were brought in to check in, and I don't remember her being with us yet.
What happened once you got to Leyte?
Well, we were being examined for bugs, and we couldn't go to America till we had passed all their health requirements. So we were there about a month. It was, to me, a long time. And I think she joined us on the ship. I'm not sure when we came back.
Did you get deloused?
Deloused is right. Yeah, bed bugs. Yeah.
Your constant companions before that, I would guess.
Yeah. Well, it was surprising. In Bilibid, we probably picked up more than we did in Baguio, yeah.
Now, my recollection is when people got deloused back then, it was DDT they were spraying then.
Yeah, you were bathed in it. But it was, I've used DDT on the yard before they put, I was unaware of the danger.
Did you get any new sets of clothing then?
I think we did. I saw a picture where I have a hat on. It isn't a straw hat. And rain gear.
Well, that's a picture on the voyage home. That's a picture we're looking here.
See, that's what would have been issued to us.
Okay. We can go back a couple pictures. And I wanted to go back to there's pictures of some of the prisoners that these are actually images from a Life magazine article right after the liberation. And right. That gives you an idea of what the military prisoners would have been like, but even the families.
Yes.
It's horrific conditions. And I think one more maybe, and to see the pictures of you three girls standing on the right. That's those yellow dresses that Francis was talking about, isn't it?
Yes, that was all we had.
Yeah. Well, somewhere in here you shot up.
Yeah. I was hungry all the time, I know that. But, I don't know why. It looks tall, but...
Okay. Now, let's go back to the time you were at Leyte. What did you guys do to keep busy while you were there waiting?
They had movies at night for us, and because my mother and father were... preoccupied or something, we got to know a soldier that took the three of us to the movies. You couldn't go on your own. And so we watched movies at night. And by day, we were lined up for examinations and whatnot. It was just another step toward getting home eventually.
Now, this might be a curious question for you, but do you remember any of those movies you saw?
No. I wish I could, but everybody was so new. Everything was so new. It was something to watch, but it didn't hit or make an impact.
Having this freedom now after 3 years in prison camp, did it feel strange or different to you?
Oh, we were careful. You couldn't go wandering even in peacetime with the soldiers around. No, we stuck together and we did what they said to do, and it was just, we had organization, we had food, we couldn't complain.
Okay. How about the trip back home? How did you get from Leyte to the United States?
That was tough. That was a long trip. It took almost a month, maybe 3 weeks, to go from Leyte to San Francisco, because we had to go by way of Australia. Japanese torpedoes were out, and so that had to be avoided. So it took a while. In the ship, you got sick. Oh, did you? They didn't have stabilizers in those days, and you rocked. And the only cure for that was just eat soda crackers and water. That was your diet.
So it doesn't sound like you enjoyed the trip back to the United States.
No. We had a lot of practice trying drills for if we were hit by torpedoes, what to do on the ship or off the ship even.
Did you go back as part of a convoy, or was it independent?
To my knowledge, no convoy. It was the Admiral Capps. It was a troop ship that slept seven in bunks going up on the vertical.
Yeah, so this is built to for American troops to be hauled back and forth.
Right, right.
Not exactly the comforts for civilians, huh?
No, and we had several die. It was the first time I had seen a death at sea. And it still to this day bothers me when I hear taps, because that's what they do. And then the coffin is dropped down a chute to the water. And it's sad after living through a war than to end up dying on the ship coming home.
Oh. These are some of the civilian prisoners that
yes,
were dying?
Yes, yes. So it was sad.
How was your mother doing?
I think fine. I really don't remember any incident. I don't know if she even still slept with us. She possibly was united with us on the ship, but I couldn't tell you.
Was there anything to keep all the girls occupied?
We watched the waves and kind of walked around the ship. It really wasn't nothing I can remember reading, or libraries or anything. Movies, no.
Okay. How about the crew? Did the crew treat?
Oh, they were good. Yeah.
Were these American sailors or a merchant marine ship?
Oh, there I wouldn't know. Admiral Capps, whatever.
The USS Admiral Capps, and that's really all I know about it.
Yeah.
A troop ship that saw action long after World War II, as I recall.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's something that your mother wrote after she got to the United States, and she, you guys were suddenly the fascination of news reporters across the country.
These, Those sisters get together, they know who to call.
Well, she told one reporter that the girls, quote, had never known table service in camp. Well, yeah.
Yeah.
The Civil War table linens and waiters fascinated them. Marie chose sliced onions and vinegar for dessert. Probably don't remember that.
No, I don't.
It's just, I'm sure it struck your mother as not the kind of thing most people would ask for dessert.
No, huh? I wouldn't.
Okay. Do you remember arriving in the United States? And was this San Francisco?
Yes.
Do you remember that?
I do. It only because President Roosevelt had died at that time. And so there's a funeral going on or planned. So it was more that an incident had happened. It wasn't just getting off a ship. It was the president has died and things are happening. But we didn't tarry there very long. The government put us up in a hotel and it was up to us to get out of there. And my mother's sisters and her cousin from San Francisco met us with clothes. So we were getting help from the family right away.
Okay. One last passage here from your father's account that he wrote, and this is the last portion that he wrote about. So then he got on, began his life again after this. But this is arriving in the United States. Very brief passage.
It was a great feeling to get back to the States. The children had a great deal to see. They were just babies when they went to the Philippines. The oldest one said, "Dad, I've been in jeeps, trucks, landing barges, airplanes, large boats, but we haven't been on a streetcar yet. And one more thing, when the bellhop opened the door to our room, one of the youngsters said, 'Doesn't it look beautiful? Do we live here?'"
I'm sure it looked luxurious compared to what you'd known before.
Oh, it was. And it was wonderful that my aunt had a nice house too. So to take five people in, that's pretty great. When she had four children of her own, that's six. So there were 11 and 12. That's a lot of people to feed.
Where was this aunt?
In Chicago. We took the train from San Francisco to Chicago and joined up with them.
Anything memorable about that train trip?
Not really. It was the Santa Fe. That's all I can remember. I was looking for gold streets. Somehow America was supposed to be paved with gold and there was no gold streets, but I didn't complain. It was just regular life. Little setback.
Well, certainly the daughter of a gold mine supervisor in the Philippines should know that, but
we always used to ask, "What's America like?" Well, it's paved with gold, and that was in our mind.
Wow. I would imagine, though, that long train ride, that's got to be several days train ride.
At least three or two, like you said. Things kept moving. I mean, distractions happened. People talk to you, but I don't remember it being ugly, nice. What? It was a train.
Okay. The people you're on the train with, then they weren't people who had just been released from prison?
Not necessarily, no. We all went to our families in our own way.
Were people interested, curious about the story that you all had to tell?
When we got back to Chicago.
Did you want to talk to people about it, or were you tired, got tired of talking to people about it?
No, I don't remember that at all. I just remember getting back and getting into a normal life as far as talking to people. We did do some talking, prodded by mother and dad, really. The aunts also, they wanted you to talk to their pastor or come and talk to this one and that one.
Now, today we hear so much about men in combat, men and women in combat coming back and having very tough circumstances and having a difficulty in making the adjustments and dealing with things. Do you recall having any difficulty in adjusting to life? I mean, serious difficulties.
No, I was raised strictly. And I think the way you're raised, your culture, I was obedient, and so if you're arty and think you can go on your own or do something, then you might run into conflict. But I don't remember.
Did you have recurring nightmares or difficulty sleeping, mm-hmm. anything like that?
No, I don't. I may have bothered some people if I talk, but I sleep.
But you had told us before your mother had a very difficult time, not just after she was released, but even during her imprisonment, especially then.
Yes, my mother, reality in her life was what should be, not what is. And she had pretty nervous breakdowns, and even going to the Philippines was very hard on her. A foreign country when she was used to the convent and quiet and everything starched and neatly presented, food, then to be married and in a foreign country that she knew nothing of, she had a hard time. Hmm. She was very angry, very frustrated. And took it out a little bit on the Japs too. They shouldn't be there, and she shouted at them that they shouldn't be there. She broke down, I think.
And as we talked about last time, she took it out on you quite a bit, sounds like.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
Did that situation improve for her when she got back to the United States?
Not necessarily. I think I was a substitute boy in the family. If things needed cutting or things needed fixing or a driver. I can't believe in recollection, that they would buy a car that neither of them that could drive, only I could drive it. And I think I was chauffeur, cook, and before the car I used to, you know, washing clothes. We didn't have money for a washing machine. So in the bathtub in the evenings, we would wash clothes and use our feet like the Filipinos and stomp your clothes and rub it. Then we would dry them out on a line.
This is in the United States?
Yes. We didn't have money for a washing machine. And if something was large, a comforter or something, I would pedal my bike with the comforter in the back of it and drive it to a laundromat. So we really were still very poor.
When you lived in Baguio before the war, it sounded like you had a rather privileged life. Your father was a very successful mining engineer.
That's right.
What did he end up doing when he came back to the United States?
A mining engineer at Peabody Coal. But the difference is that you couldn't afford maids and a new home with three girls getting ready for college or going to high school. There just wasn't enough money. And she didn't go to work.
Your mother didn't?
No.
Where were you living then after you spent a few weeks with your aunt?
Well, we'd moved from one aunt to another until August, and I think somewhere around August, we went to Taylorville.
This would be August of 45?
45. And
also August of 1945, August 6th, the first atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima. And August 9th, the second was dropped on Nagasaki. And a couple weeks, then shortly after that, the informal surrender and then the formal surrender ceremony. how much did you even understand about what an atomic bomb was at that time?
None at all.
In retrospect,
yeah.
This is a controversy you often hear. You think President Truman made the right decision to use those bombs?
It's sad. We had it. I don't know what made him trigger it, but all you can do is go along and believe that, knowing the Japs, they would have they thrown it at us first if they had.
Well, one of the statements that your mom made in this same letter that I read from earlier, that same letter on February 20th, and this is just, 3 weeks after her release from the prison camp. Here's what she said. "By all that is just in the sight of Almighty God, Japan will be crawling until the world's end." So, how did you feel about the Japanese at that time in your life?
It was tough. I really didn't like them.
Did you hate them?
Yes. And it was my neighbor in Decatur that had a husband that was Japanese engineer working at Caterpillar. He was the nicest man and made me see through that hatred, that it was unwarranted.
When was that?
In, 19, or I had two children then. So 54, 55, 56, somewhere. Yeah.
So 10 years afterwards.
Yeah. But, right, you didn't, I hadn't any association with Japanese before that, after the prison. And so the hatred was definitely there, but it went away. Maybe youth can do it too, where my mother was older.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Let's talk about, you've got a picture up here now, the Quiz Kids show. Tell me about that.
Oh,
that you're the tall girl standing there, right?
Yeah.
And this is a radio show. I know that much about it.
Yeah, the Quiz Kids were brilliant people that knew all the answers to questions that you would try and trip them up. And they were very popular to listen to. And my aunts decided that that may be of interest to the Quiz Kids, that we appear and talk about our experience. It was very minute. It was just a landmark. And today, like you, what are the Quiz Kids? So it was a time, and they had every newspaper, radio show they could put together. I don't think we got money for anything. It was just that we were free.
Did you mind talking about your experiences?
Kind of. I'm not one to share sad, or it wasn't my success or my failure. So until we got in school, and then we talked about some of our customs that were different. I don't know if we talked about it there, but in the Philippines, you have all this rain coming down, and we'd walk up the 100 and so steps to our house, and our shoes would be wet, our socks. Well, and walking down too, in the rainy season, typhoon season, when you got to school, you would automatically take off your socks and your shoes and hang them to dry. And we pulled that one off in Chicago at one school, and the kids laughed. They never saw that before. And so in the Philippines, mold is a big problem. And so people have lights on in the closets to ward off the mold accumulating on their shoes. And so, you know, we did things a little different. Mm.
You mentioned you started school in Chicago. I guess you would have come back right towards the end of the school year, but school was definitely going on. Did your folks get you right back into school
right
again?
Back in, yeah.
You were...
To my age group, too.
What, 10 or 11 at the time,
yeah,
then?
Yeah, sixth grade.
Were you ready for sixth grade?
Oh, no. I didn't know how to add or multiply. I could add, but not multiply or divide. Those were the big things, but... We weren't in the school long enough. It just got us occupied until we moved to Taylorville. Okay. So it was, we had a month or maybe two at the most.
Okay. Well, I'll hold off. I got more questions about your schooling in Taylorville. But before I get there, did your family, your father especially, did he consider going back to the Philippines? There must have been a job there waiting for him if he wanted it.
That was something I remember. I wasn't sure he was going to stay with my mother. She was going back to America. He didn't have a job. And things were, she was sick. She was high strung. I wasn't sure that there was a lot of talk about he may stay in the Philippines, but he chose to join us.
And you're happy that he did.
Yeah, he's it really, it's, you need mom and dad.
You had an awful lot to worry about as a very young girl then.
Well, I was mother for a while. And so.
How was it that, I'm curious, this is something you mentioned before, but how is it that a mining engineer doesn't know how to drive a car?
I have no idea why. I never questioned. You're doing things that I just never question. And why he didn't, I tried to teach my mother, but I didn't try and teach him. He didn't show any interest. He worked, he had 12-hour jobs that he really had enough on him that without driving her to the store or something, I'm sure.
Okay. Now, I'm sure you're elated to be back in the United States. Was there anything about your life in pre-war Baguio that you missed?
Christmas. Christmas, that the roller skates. We didn't, because you're foreign in, we did not have many friends our age. And so the war gave us some friendships our age. But we had wanted to learn how to roller skate, and that was going to be our Christmas present. And of course, we had to leave that behind. We didn't have a Christmas.
Okay. I would imagine, though, once the family moves to Taylorville, there's plenty of kids to play with.
Yes, and it worked out well.
Tell me about Taylorville at the time you guys got there. What kind of a community was it?
A small one. And mining was the big thing. There was a paper mill, but mining, coal mining. And of course, when everyone was occupied, it was a great town. The kids behaved, they were all busy. Then the mining was stopped, I believe, for green reasons.
For
the coal
ecological
mine.
Reasons?
Yeah, ecological, yeah. So my father was never one to be slow at the draw. When he built this mine number 10, and it was the world's largest producing coal mine, and when they closed that down, he went to New York and became a water safety engineer in the tunnels in New York.
And, New York City area?
Yes. And I can remember visiting him, and they went down so deep that he got the bends coming up too fast from the tunnels. And I don't... I guess once a miner, you're always in tunnels. Mm. But he had a great job. When that contract was done, Healy Corporation was his contractor. Then he went to Dillon and put in the one of the engineers to put in the water system for Dillon, for Denver. From Lake Dillon is the water system.
That sounds like your dad wasn't always home.
No, he was getting jobs. Well, you move to a job. I'm amazed when people are let out here, they go on unemployment and that's it.
Did the family, though, stay in Taylorville?
Until they could relocate. My mother decided that he was moving around so much that she moved to Decatur and nearby. So I was still chauffeuring her to the store and whatnot. Mm-hmm. But no, he was very proud of the work they did. I remember him saying they took three rivers on the continental mountains, the Blue River and whatnot, and they were off 6 inches when they got the tunnel built without a laser, without the equipment we have today. And they thought that was great.
That is amazing. Okay, where did you go to grade school once you got to Taylorville?
I went to St. Mary's Catholic School. The Precious Blood Order ran it. And the nuns were very devout and very helpful to me they kept us after school and would tutor us so we would catch up with our grades.
So all three of the girls got some individual attention while
yeah,
you were there?
Yes.
We got a picture of you on the right. You said earlier today that's a little bit after you got back to the United States.
Yeah, we didn't have clothes. We didn't have, it was interesting.
Well, you look very healthy in that picture though, Marianne.
Yes, yes.
Where are you in this large class picture?
On the top row on the right, the second one.
The second girl in?
Right.
From the right, okay.
Mm-hmm. And so, hair's a little better. Psychologically, we had a lot to learn. And so...
You mentioned your math skills were really way behind your classmates.
Mm-hmm.
How about your reading skills and writing skills?
Reading was fine, but don't ask me anything about geography and history. I'm not very good at that, but...
How about cursive writing? Had you started learning cursive writing?
The nuns had us. We did our cursive.
I've got this image in my mind of nuns hovering over you while
yes.
you're watching you
yes.
do cursive.
Yes, and getting that wrist right. Yes, we learned. It wasn't so important as the math. And by eighth grade, I was almost top of the class. So
not just caught up, but...
Yeah, doing well, except history.
What was your parents' expectations? Nothing less than being at the top?
No, do you know that wasn't big on there. We got ourselves up and went to school on our bikes. They didn't expect that.
Does that mean you still were kind of the mother hen for your two younger
yeah.
sisters?
Well, I was for me and my sister next. The baby mother had, and she didn't really apply herself too much. I was talking to my son about Cecile, who was the youngest, and he said there is some evidence that the brain is not completely developed by four. And he said she went into the prison at 3 and 4. And she's been, well, we call it spoiled brat, but she's been always different in her thinking than we were. And it could be the war. Tom said that there is evidence of it, We don't know. Hmm. But my sister and I did well in school once we applied ourselves.
Did Cecile, was that your
the baby sister, yeah.
Did your mother treat her differently than she did you?
Oh, yes. Well, she was always, she went to, my mother went to America before the war and took Cecile because she wasn't old enough to go to school. And so, because of her age or whatever reason.
Were you all still faithful churchgoers at that time?
Yes.
Did your father go with you?
He went. He when he could. Otherwise, he was working. He worked constantly.
What was the parish that you went to?
Oh, St. Mary's in Taylorville.
So St. Mary's Church and St. Mary's School.
School. That's right.
Okay. I don't know enough about Catholic traditions to know if there is a youth group or certain expectations for young girls in the church. You certainly wouldn't have been altar boy. Was there anything equivalent to that?
There was when I got to high school, because they have for children who do not go to a Catholic school, and my high school was not a Catholic school. We had meetings on Wednesday night to talk about the church.
Confirmation classes, essentially?
We had confirmation, and First Communion was done in Baguio. Confirmation, and that was it. Then I went on to Loyola. And
I'm curious, did you go to confessional then when you were growing up?
Yes.
How often was that?
In Taylorville, yeah. It was Saturday night, and Saturday night is date night. And you knew right now that you better be good because God's watching you and on your date.
So did you go to confession before or after the
before
date?
Before, at 3. My. I mean, she knew what she was doing. And I don't know if parents have the control that she had, but you went to confession every Saturday. And then you went out on a date, and you better be good.
Taylorville High School, right?
Yeah.
Did you get involved in extracurricular activities?
Oh, yes.
What was that?
Everything. The Girls Athletic Association. I was chosen as the DAR Award winner, and then president of the Red Cross, president of this and that, which is kind of begging for friends. I mean, I had friends galore.
Did you went out of your way to make sure you had plenty of friends?
I was always nice to, yeah. I didn't worry if they didn't involve me with something. I didn't go that far. But I had friends.
And it doesn't sound like you had any problems getting the boys interested in you.
No, that wasn't really a big factor in my life.
Well, going on dates after confessional, though,
yeah.
Was.
Yeah. Well, that's, I finally had a steady boy, but that was like the senior year. And then you just behaved yourself.
Okay. I think of one picture back here. We've got a picture of you in high school. Two pictures. One, tell me about the picture on the left here.
Oh, that is my gang. We met on Wednesday nights and probably talked about people, and it was gang.
Was this a informal group?
Yeah, that was informal.
Well,
I thought I
was a little bit more dressed up than a gang of women would be today. Most of you have your pearls there, it looks like.
Yeah, all of them were just gangs. We thought we should have a picture. So we dressed up for it.
Very good.
I mean, we were close.
And the picture on the right?
Yeah, that's prom.
Who's the young man you were with?
Oh, he's just another student. I went to grade school with him in high school, Richard Bloxham. But we drifted.
Well, it looks like, though, from these two pictures, at least, Marianne, that you had a good time in high school.
I did. Is that good or bad? I'm
well,
not sure.
That's what you're supposed to be doing. Were you working in high school as well?
Yes. I lifeguarded at the swimming pool and in the winter worked at Blakely's department store. Oh, and I started off with Rini's drugstore as a soda jerk or whatever.
Okay. Back when they still had those kinds of things.
Yeah. I think Rini still has it.
Did you have Bobby socks?
Oh, yes.
You were one of those girls?
Well, I was looking to see. Yeah, we had Bobby socks.
Was this before Elvis or right about the time Elvis was coming out?
No, Elvis is much later.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. What did your parents want you to do after high school?
They just go to college. They didn't care.
And that was the expectation all along?
Yeah, just go to college.
What did you want to do with your life?
Because of the money, it was unrealistic that I could go all 4 years to Loyola and have room and board. I was one of the first women that Loyola had. They did not have women at their college in Chicago until the year I went up there. And so I had to rent a room, and it was expensive. I would have done just what I did later anyway, get my degree slowly and work. Some of the gals at Loyola worked on the transit system, and they made pretty good money, and they still graduated in the class. So the dream of quitting in that speed was something that my mother didn't want. After all, I was now dating, and she was happy with the date I had.
There's a long way away from Taylorville to Loyola University.
Yeah.
Was that your plan, to get away from home a little bit?
No, it wasn't to get away. I somehow had met the Jesuits, and I'm a big found follower of Jesuits. And in fact, five of my children graduated from St. Louis U. So it's just their manner of thinking, and that way I could afford myself to and mm-hmm. work.
I think I know the answer to this next question, but did you ever consider at this point in your life to becoming a nun?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
A medical missionary. Yes. They were, I was interested in nursing, and the medical missionary would have been fine.
Now, you mentioned that you were one of the very first women to go to Loyola University at that time. Did they have a nursing program? Had they just started a nursing program?
They just started it,
okay.
Yeah.
And we've got a picture of you in your nursing outfit right there.
Right.
1952 to 54, but that's not quite long enough to get an undergraduate degree.
Right.
Okay, so now?
Now we just get married.
So tell me about, you just kind of alluded to starting to date. Who were you dating at the time?
Well, a Notre Dame student from Mount Pulaski that I met on a blind date, and he was everything that my mother liked.
What was his name?
George Hubbard.
He was everything that your mother liked, but you met him on a blind date.
Yeah, and it worked out. The trade-off was I got to see Notre Dame. I got to see things that I couldn't afford or couldn't have. It was companionable.
Okay. How long into the relationship did that get serious?
Well, we dated about 2 years. It was serious with him, but he had to graduate from Notre Dame, and he did. And he was assigned to San Diego Naval Base. And so I had to make up my mind if I wanted to lose him or keep him.
That would have been a time when all of the young men would have had some kind of a military obligation.
Yes, and he did. And I chose to lose him. And when I told my mother, she raised heck and said, "No, he's a fine boy. You just don't have any taste," and a few other things. So I abducted my career of nursing and accepted his wedding ideas. And we went to San Diego then after marriage.
So you were ready to walk away from this relationship?
Yes.
And
well, with the choice, either or, that doesn't give you much. And I think I'm one of the first women or not, in that era that we're starting to think longer term.
Maybe a career and not necessarily marriage and family.
Right, right. The 50s were that you got married, and I'm at the edge of the 50s where this historically women have a career and use it.
You mentioned your mother, that she had a definite opinion about what you should do.
Right.
How about your dad?
Never said a word. He came home, went to work, and it was a shame. There just was no opinion.
Were you not that close with your father?
I was very close, but not speaking. We probably, a good counselor would have a ball with us. But my dad was very protective. He earned the money and then went to bed and then went to work.
Did he not want to take on your mother in situations like
that? I don't
that?
Think he could have changed her. No, none at all. She was bent to go where she wanted to go, and we were doing things right.
Was she, I don't want to put words in your mouth, was she adamant about you needing to get married?
Well, to George, yeah. If it had been somebody else, I don't know. Yeah.
Well, what was about George? Had she met him a lot and really liked him?
The family.
His family?
Yes, elitist. They're banking people, farm, oil companies. It's a trait, I think, of the Irish a bit. What does he do? Yeah.
Now, you might not want to answer this, but at the time, did you love George?
No. I wished him well, but I knew it was a big mistake. I should have quit.
But you got married anyway.
Yeah, I did it. And I didn't really have an alternative. Unless I wanted to leave home and tell her to go jump in the lake.
Well, tell me a little bit more about his personality and his interest and his career.
George?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, he really isn't career-minded, but he had a good income coming in, being in the ROTC.
ROTC program.
Yeah, the Navy program. But the heir of the time, he did man things. He hunted. He had money to do things. He ball games, buy what he wanted. And I almost, at one time, I tried to join him. I tried the hunting. It didn't work.
Well, we got a couple pictures here. Here you are holding
a
good-sized shotgun.
Yeah. I almost shot him one time accidentally when I was loading one of those.
Oh.
The trigger bounced on it, and I didn't see where the gun was pointed.
And it went off?
Yeah. Yeah.
You got his attention that time, huh?
Well, you know, damn it, Phil, get your gun. You do it. But anyway, it's not all lost for it. Today, the women, we would not do that. We would stand up.
But you at least tried to make an effort to become interested in the things he was interested in, it looks
yeah.
like.
Yeah.
You got married in 54, big wedding, big ceremony?
Yeah, of course, in Chicago at the Beach Hotel, Edgewater Beach.
I assume he was going to Notre Dame. He was a good Catholic boy.
Oh, yes.
And was he a faithful churchgoer with you?
Yeah. Well, we went to different masses, but he went to church, yeah.
Okay. And after he had his military service, what did he end up doing for a living?
He came back to Mount Pulaski. I was for staying in the service if we were going to do anything. And he didn't have a job, and his father owned an oil company, or oil something. And so he went down to Robinson, Illinois, and worked on the oil fields. Then, and I stayed in Mount Pulaski and finally at in-laws, and finally moved to Taylorville because my parents were out of the house. Excuse me. But it was just a different era of time that I've lost track of the thought that he was looking for a job. Well, the next thing he heard, the power company was hiring. So he became an accountant or something at the power company. And he looked up the wages for the president of the company, and he thought the president wasn't paid enough. He's not going to stay in that career. And he went in and became a stockbroker.
Okay. That was still in the 50s sometime?
Yeah.
Well, how soon was it that you started to have children?
Immediately, 9 months, every 9 months or 11 months. And because I always thought God would strike me dead if I used a condom or anything like were available.
That sounds like it pretty much, though, those children coming along so quickly tied you down to the home.
Right.
Did you have a desire even in those early years to get back out and have some kind of a career outside of the home?
No, I thought this really was, I'll give it the good try, and I love the kids. But as time went on, by the time I was 28, I realized this isn't going to work. He's not going to be making, and if he is making it, he isn't going to share. So I suspected I better have some backup somewhere, someday.
By 28, mm-hmm. You've been married, what, about 8 years by that time?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm. How many children did you have at that time?
Six. And so...
Well, you didn't waste any time.
No. But that was expected in those days.
Boys, girls, both?
Boy, girl, both, yeah. Boy, girl, in sequence. But anyway, as I looked at what we were raising, and they may want to go to college, I thought it would be wise to get a job and get busy. I wasn't going anywhere, you know, so.
How did your experiences in the Philippines, and maybe even more relevant, how did your experiences with your mother affect the way you wanted to raise your own children?
I was more laissez-faire, you know, as far as making decisions for them. They made their own. When they got married, they made their own, and they really had to afford their own. All the kids paid for their own colleges. The wedding, I think George could have helped on But on college, I thought I helped them get jobs, but they just, there wasn't that sharing from coming from the father.
Was George pretty active with the kids?
If it was a ball game or something, he was, but otherwise, he was a drive-by farmer. He put the kids on the farm and then drive by and yell out the window what he wanted done and then keep driving.
Mm. Okay. Well, tell me about then the decision at 28 years old, what you wanted to do. How do you started to put your life in a different direction?
Right. And it's something that you have to work on. And I thought one day at a time. I couldn't see when I would graduate, but I thought, I'll work on this. I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to be a good mother. And I tried. So at 35, I finally graduated.
Were you taking night classes then?
Night and day, yeah.
What college were you going to?
Millikan. We didn't have community colleges.
So you were living in Decatur, both you and George living in Decatur at the time.
Right, right. It just, and Millikan wasn't ready for me or my girlfriend that joined me. They had rules that applied to ancient people. Like I'm going to be a teacher, a science teacher, and I had to have PE credit. And so I thought, well, I'll play golf or learn to play golf. That was one of the PE things. And they said, no, you're too old. You can't play golf or basketball or anything like that. But you can be a driver's ed teacher, and that way you've fulfilled your your credits for teaching. So I became a driver's ed teacher besides a science teacher. And so you just jumped the hoops. The math, they wanted you to take a test. And math had changed, greater than signs, less than signs. And I said, I'll ace it, but I won't know what you're talking about unless I take the course. Well, I took their pre-test, and they said, you flunked, you don't know anything. And I said, just let me get in there. Well, they didn't. And to me, it was $400, 80-some dollars a credit hour. So I was looking at money, and I could have done it straight A. As it turns out, then Millikan changed that rule, and you didn't need a pre-test to take Algebra 1.
Did Millikan know all of your history?
No.
You didn't tell him about your experiences in the Philippines or why you might have been a little behind in math from other students or anything like that?
No. It was just a dead rule. And again, I'm not going anywhere, so I can follow the rules.
Okay, you were 35 then when you got your mm-hmm. bachelor's degree.
Mm-hmm.
How many children did you have by that time?
Eight. I had eight then.
Okay. And is that when your working career starts?
Immediately. It surprised me. The teachers, the man in charge of the teachers, made a pact and placed me in science in a school, junior high, in a school that the principal said, I don't want a woman science teacher. And a Millikan professor said, that's what you'll have. I didn't have to apply for the job. I was surprised. George was hunting in Alaska, and he called home, and I said, I'm working. And he said, well, what's the difference between substitute and regular teaching? And I said, whatever it was, money, monetarily, because that's all he's interested in. And he said, you did the right thing. So I put the last one in nursery school and went to work as a science teacher.
And some of the older kids ended up doing some babysitting in the home?
Well, when Not when I'm teaching, but when I was going to school at night, yes. Oh, the kids all helped. Yeah, we had boys' night and girls' night. Boys cook one night, girls the next. Yeah, because I couldn't get home in time to get the meal, and I'm cooking for 11. So I told them I didn't care if it was peanut butter or what. You make your own menus. So they've all turned out to be good cooks.
Were they allies, allies on this cause of you getting an education?
I pushed them, so they probably saw the importance. Yeah.
Okay. Tell me about your first job then.
First job?
Teaching.
Teaching. It was interesting. I came from a parochial school where a nun say quiet, everybody did. And I'm in a public school now with 30 students and 6 classes, 180 kids a day.
This is the early 70s, right?
Yeah, and this is...
the age of Aquarius, all of that.
Oh, this is these kids. So... it was a shock to me that, you know, how am I going to keep them quiet? You can't hit them. You can't do anything. And I had 2 sections of Longview, which is your underprivileged children. And so I started taking a lot of psychology courses. And one that really helped me was I'm Okay, You're Okay, in a book that... So I drew the circles, which are parent, child, and factual. We have 3 personalities in each one of us, and I would draw the circle and say to them, you can either be a parent here, or a child, or a student with facts. And I want you to be student with facts, but then that's up to you. And I also have parent in me and child. And I said, so we're going to be communicating on that level. And in science, I had no problem after that. I'd say, is that the child in you or is that the adult? And I could control the environment in the classroom, pretty much.
Okay.
And then science, you take them to lab on one day a week, and they have their experiments, and it's an interesting subject.
You enjoyed teaching science then?
I enjoyed it. I had a good career.
Did you enjoy student driving? Driver teacher.
Oh, that was funny. Yeah. I got through that course. The professor at Millikan gave me a retired woman who was kind of out of it. And so we had to take a knife, fork, and spoon and draw and move them just like a car before. Anyway, he said, if you get her to get her license, then I'll give you an A. And she got her license. So I enjoyed people.
Well, and students pay more attention and they tend to obey more or cooperate more when they're learning how to drive because that's something they really want to do.
Oh, they do, yes. Or go to the lab.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I know that after 40 or 71 to 74, you had your first teaching job and you're looking to move up. And in part of your application or one of the evaluations that you got, here's what your principal wrote about you. Marianne is... quote, a very willing worker, always looking for new ways, new ideas, and techniques to bring her particular field of science to the students. Willing to go the extra mile in order to do this. Greatest strength lies in using teacher strategies, maybe what you're just talking about. Mm-hmm. Is most cooperative with the administration, gets along well with the teachers, students, and parents. Mm-hmm. You know who that sounds like, Marianne? That sounds like your dad to me.
Yeah. Yeah, he did. He got along with everyone.
Were you, even while you're teaching, were you taking classes on the side?
They wanted me to. They promoted me to administration. But I, before I could enter that field, I had to have my degree from U of I. So they let me off early in the afternoons to get to U of I and complete my master's in 2 years. Okay. And work full time. And that's when the kids came into having to cook. I was commuting with Champagne.
Then what did you do in after the teaching experience? Was it an administrative job then, you said?
Yes. They let me choose. Did I want to be a dean? And to me, deans are hard. You're taking pupils that are somebody else's problem. And so that wasn't my cup of tea, but I did work with a federal program that came in to Decatur, soft money, but I opted to run a program for career education. And I had worked with the public probably more than most teachers anyway, so it worked out very well.
Okay. And what came after that position?
Well, in the meantime, my husband was telling me that I should get out of teaching and go into being a broker, that I'd be a better broker than that. And sometimes, according to I'm okay, you're okay, sometimes your own husband can be your worst enemy. And in this case, I gave up a career to go into his business. And before I did that, I wanted to have a business degree because I didn't have any accounting or finance. So I took accounting at Richland, came into town, and I took accounting, and then got into the MBA through a friend of mine on the executive program where I just go on weekends to school. And that's how I got the master's. Well, George backed out of his saying, you come and work with me. And I didn't know why at the time, but he kept saying, you're on your own. And so I had given my
notice,
thank you for the word. I had given the school district my notice that I was leaving, and he backed out of the job. So I was up a creek, and I thought, well, I've got to go forward. If he says there's money to be made, I better move forward. So Commerce Clearinghouse had an ad in the paper, and I took it, interviewed with them, and took the job. It was 15 counties of tax books that I would be servicing. Well, I doubled my money, and my earnings, rather. So it wasn't too bad, but it was a lot of travel.
Now, I know that you told me already this is not your strength, but do you remember roughly what year this would have been that you quit the teaching positions?
I was there 10 years teaching. I mean,
in different capacities?
Different capacities.
So it sounds like early 1980s?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. How many children did you have by this time?
I had 9. And in fact, Katie was just born then, the baby. So we were working. I hired help to babysit so I could continue these.
Most normal women with 9 kids, that would have been a full-time job in and of itself.
It was. At night I washed 3 loads of laundry and folded 3 loads, and the kids would come and pick out their laundry.
Did you manage to get them to church as well?
Oh, yes. Yeah, they went with me. They did. Yeah.
And what was the parish in Decatur that you were attending?
At that time, Our Lady of Lourdes out north on north end of town.
When were you able to finally become a stockbroker?
E.F. Hutton, after the first year of CCH, E.F. Hutton announced that they were coming to Decatur. And I thought, that's what I wanted anyway. So I interviewed for E.F. Hutton, and they told me the most important trait they were looking for was sales experience. And I had it with CCH, Commerce Clearinghouse. I had a year. They said, fine, we'll train you on the stocks and the commodities, but you need that sales. And it worked out. They hired me. I said, what about my husband? He's A.G. Edwards' broker. Oh, he can be that, but we'll take you. And it didn't bother them that there was competition between us.
At first, it was your husband that was encouraging you, mm-hmm. maybe even stronger than that, wanting you to become a stockbroker?
Exactly, and I think because he was traveling so much, I could be a good babysitter for his career, his clients.
Oh.
I didn't get the idea that this was a 50-50, but I'm smart, I know.
But now you're a competitor.
Right.
Was he okay with you being a competitor?
He didn't have a choice, but we worked out well. We would ask each other, what does your company say about this? What does your company say about that? When E.F. Hutton speaks, everybody listens. And so we would talk about it and have a drink in the evenings. And it went on like that.
Now we've got a picture of you and your husband with some other people at some kind of an event with stockbrokers, I believe, and the two of you are on the right there.
Right. He won a trip to Paris, and that is in Paris with the winners. And at that point, that's when I had told him I have filed for divorce.
That you filed for divorce. What led to that, if you don't mind me asking?
Finding Saks Fifth Avenue boxes and a few presents to somebody else. So it was evident that this was not going to change for the better. And since I was just starting out, it took 2 years. The lawyers are very slow, non-contested.
Do you think that had been going on for a while behind your back?
Possibly. I really, I was so busy, I didn't really care. But since I am in a position making decisions now, I had to care.
Did he contest the divorce?
No, neither of us. No.
What did your children? There's nine
other kids. Oh, they were shocked. And our friends, Henry Staley of Staley Company, called and said, Marianne, you just can't do this. And I said, I'm so sorry. I didn't want to say it's his fault. It was my fault for marrying him. I should have fought. I knew it. So I really didn't come to the conclusion that somebody should be blamed.
But this is 33 years of your life?
Yes, and it was getting more and more relevant that I should do something.
You had nine children. Most of them were adults by this time.
Yes.
Had careers and families of their own. Did the kids kind of take sides in this?
Not too much, no. One did. The one that was the horseman, that her hobby was riding horses and whatnot. She was close to her father. And that was it. It was, I felt sorry, but it wasn't getting better, and they saw the evidence.
Most of the children then were they supportive?
Yeah, very, very.
Did you have any kids still at home?
Yes. Katie was young, and her big problem was that we're in the house, and what if somebody comes in? Protection. And I said, I can handle that. We can handle that. And eventually the idea came that we were safe and we could handle ourselves.
Do you know roughly when the divorce occurred then? My understanding was somewhere around 1987. Does that sound right?
It could be. It was in the spring sometime.
Okay. How were you financially at the time?
Well, I had income, but really this was the income is what I was earning and split the house and that's it.
Did you get a settlement from George in any way?
No, he incorporated everything in companies. This is a trick that is used by a lot of people that know how this is company money. Well, where did it come from? I couldn't prove what he did, but there was nothing. And it wasn't making sense. It was just get out and be practical.
Okay. Divorce is one thing, but you're Catholic as well. Was there annulment?
Yes. And it wasn't through me. It was through his girlfriend that he had. She is very wealthy in Chicago and millionaire. And I think he saw dollar signs and she arranged the annulment. We had it in 6 weeks.
Did he get remarried then shortly after that?
Right. He was married in a few months.
How much pain did this cause you at the time?
It was a relief. It was the first honest thing that was going on, as far as I was concerned. I've used this. I've been through a war, and you know it was a clean fight, or it was evident fight. But one of the things, the other thing I did was pull the kids out of Catholic school, only because there were things that weren't educating, they were training. There's a difference.
You mean indoctrinating?
Indoctrinating children. You can't talk. Well, they had rules. You can't talk the first hour because you're going to Mass. And the second hour, you can't talk because you're eating lunch. So for 2 hours straight, they can't talk. Well, I mentioned this to the pastor, and I said, you know, in my education courses, you should be able to talk at least during lunch. No, they couldn't talk. And he didn't change it. So I pulled them out. And one of mine said to me when they went to the public school, this is fun. Do you know we laugh today? And it was something I didn't regret. Now, I don't believe that in every school that happens. But in this case, it was training versus education. And it was something that I just couldn't believe. You can't talk during lunch. The Japs let us talk during lunch. So that's where I came from.
Hmm. Well, that's an interesting observation, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What did you think then after you got the divorce and the annulment and everything? Were you interested at all in dating?
No. I had to really assess my life, and Kate was in high school by then, the baby. And when she graduated, then I thought, she went to St. Louis U. I thought, I'm going to change. I was working for Merrill Lynch at that time, and they had an office in Chesterfield in St. Louis that I could use and get. And so I sold the house and built a home in Chesterfield with the money. And Kate could come and stay and have her friends, and I'd see her on weekends. And I rented an apartment in Decatur until my 3 years were up that I could move for Merrill. It really worked out well. I don't know if that answers your question.
Mm-hmm. You sounded like you were reluctant to move away from education as a career field to being a stockbroker, but it also, I get the impression you were a successful stockbroker.
Yes, I used the same skills. Just ask people where they're wanting to go or what do they believe in, and money, and then prescribe.
What was George's opinion about you being successful at this?
He hated it. In fact, he said to me, I had a son that died, and he was at the funeral at Indicator and came to the house, and John took care of him at the country club and everything. And he said to me, "You've done well." And I said, "Thank you, I have." And that's it.
Hmm. You didn't want to pursue it any more than that, huh?
No.
Well, you just mentioned John. Somewhere between 1987 and a few years later, you decided that it was okay to start dating?
Kate was making her life. I was now not the scorekeeper for volleyball or anything. She was chose to go to Spain to study. And because of that, I thought, well, I'm on my own. But I really didn't think, my big thing was to make my acquaintance in St. Louis and volunteer for things to get girlfriends and whatnot. Then Kate went to Italy for a year with a very successful career. She was working for the embassy and studying, and she's done well and didn't need me around. So it was time that I enjoy. And really, marriage wasn't a thought I had anyway. Where would I like to live, in what city?
You didn't mind being alone?
No, not at all.
After all those years where you had a busy and maybe sometimes even a chaotic lifestyle at
yeah,
home?
Yeah, yeah. No, those things fade. But the kids had come down a lot, and I was not alone. They do come often, and John knows that we have parties pretty regularly.
Okay, so the question is then, what led to the decision to get back out there, so to speak?
Well, he called me. I'm just convenient. I didn't get out there.
Okay, how did you meet him initially?
He and his...
We're talking about John Koucky now.
Right, John Koucky and his wife were clients of mine in the beginning of my career. And through the years, I saw he was a wonderful man. I'd go home and compare the difference, and I think, whew. I had opinions about that, but a city man, I think, worked well with me more than a country man.
But you knew him at first as a couple.
As a couple, and when she died, his first wife, the second wife and I were at a party, our second to-be wife, and I said, it isn't too bad to her to be alone or to be single. She said, well, I'm not going to be single long. John Koucky's going to be my husband. And I thought, okay, that's there he goes.
Were you divorced at that time then?
Yes. Oh, I've been divorced a long time.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. But
you were waiting for him. You weren't...
Well, I didn't know if he'd ever wake up, but I'd see him a lot. He'd always stop by the office a lot, but it was business.
When you say wake up, you mean get over the pain of losing his first wife?
No, just be... it could be that, but... when he was in the mood, it wasn't I that he thought about. So I knew That's all right. I wasn't suffering. I had a full life on my and a lot of good friends.
But I know that the second wife also had some health issues.
Yes, and so she became, well, she died. And the last thing in the world I thought I'd see him. And he called and said, would you like lunch? And I, that day, and I said, I've got appointments, can't do it. And, you know, it's a chance I was taking. So he said, I'll wait. We'll go to lunch later then. What time? So then that was good friendship. Yeah.
Now, you'd known John well enough to know that he had two ex-wives. Was there something about that experience, too, and what happened in those marriages?
After the war, why would you worry about those things?
Well, I'm wondering that did you observe him taking care of his wives well? Was that an
influence? That was the big thing. He was very good to his wives, very good. And, you know, he had a business as a vice president of a company. He had to figure out how to, I can't tell you how much he had to do with the wives, and he can tell that himself, but he was very dedicated.
What business was he in?
Management of a company, vice president of a tool company.
Do you have an engineering background?
Yes. Shout to me. What how would I describe the company?
I think he mentioned to me he was a metallurgical engineer. Does that sound right?
Right, but he was in charge of the manufacturing.
Okay, so he was on the management end of this.
Yes.
Well, here's another question for you. Were there similarities between John and your father?
Oh, possibly. Well,
and both engineers, but that's...
Yeah, temperament, they're both peaceful. Yeah, both peaceful. Yeah. They wouldn't throw a knife or throw anything at you.
Do you remember, how long was it before the question of marriage came up then, that you were dating?
It was at least 6 months. Yeah, it was a while.
Do you remember when he asked the question?
Sure. We went at the restaurant, I remember, when we talked about it. I don't think we've talked about it since that much, but yeah, in St. Louis. We've had a lot of fun.
Did it take you long to decide you were going to say yes?
No, not at all. I trusted him.
Okay.
You can trust pretty well when you see how the money goes. And he's conservative, and yeah, I didn't see 62 horses to feed. common sense would tell you that's not right for me.
62 horses, is that a reference to George's lifestyle?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Well, there's a couple more pictures. We got a picture up here now. Cecilia, Marie, and Marianne. Can you tell me where that picture was taken? These are the three sisters, obviously.
That's taken in Chicago at the time of Francis' birthday. And I don't know, was it his 70th or 50th or what? But they requested that we come. And my sister lived in North Carolina, South Carolina, somewhere. And so she had to come in to do that.
We got one more picture here. A wedding, Jim and Ann Herzog. Well, Herzog, that's a good St. Louis name, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Cardinals.
Is Jim Herzog the son of Whitey Herzog?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes. Very nice.
So she's married into baseball royalty, so to speak.
Exactly. And she's a good athlete.
Now we can see her in the white dress, and three people to the left is Mary Ann, is yourself.
Yeah, Shorty there.
Well, you know, I look at that picture and I wonder, I know you're probably a couple inches shorter than in your prime, maybe, but I wonder how much taller you might have been had you had a decent diet those 3.5 years in the Philippines.
Yeah, I went from 5'6 to 5'2, but I don't worry about it. I'm pretty healthy.
How tall is Ann?
6'2.
6'2.
Her father was, what, well, 6'1", 5'11".
Okay. And I was told that when I saw this picture the first time, that's not the whole family. That's not all the children and all the grandchildren.
No, it isn't at all. There's a son missing in there, and then more children.
John told me that there's 21 missing from this picture. Does that sound right?
Yes.
Well, then you've been blessed in that regard.
Oh, we have fun. Yeah.
How well did these two families mix together? Because John brought some children himself to the marriage, right?
Right. And we all get along. And, you know, if you have a quirk, it doesn't matter. We know who, everybody's welcome.
So this is a great blessing in your life, I would guess.
It's everything I would like.
2006, I believe, there was an opportunity to go to Norfolk, Virginia. Can you tell me about that experience? This was a reunion?
Reunion from the prisoner of war camp. It was interesting. There are a lot of films they showed that were on YouTube. The Battle of Manila was one I saw there. They say they're doing this in these reunions, even though that we're getting older and dying off. They want to contribute the history to the Filipinos, who were very close and very, very useful to the war. I don't know how many 100,000 Filipinos and the Bataan boys were killed.
Well, I know that early on, of course, the Japanese came in with the attitude that we were liberating all of these areas, the Dutch East Indies, the Philippines, because, you know, the Americans were occupiers, et cetera. Mm-hmm. But did you ever get a sense the Filipinos were rejoicing that the Japanese were there?
No, never. The guerrillas were supported by the Filipinos, and we're grateful to the Filipinos for their actions. It was a mess.
I have read, at least I understand, that that was something of a surprise to the Japanese, that the Filipinos took attitude.
Yeah, I don't think I ever suspected that, but
you never had a question of the loyalty of the Filipino people?
No.
Okay.
That they were, and that still continues.
Have you gone to many other of these reunions?
Just a couple, two or three, two, yeah.
Are they hard sometimes to go to see these people?
No. These people are stunned that I'm still alive because of the harsh treatment that my mother put on us. But other than that, no, they're old friends, and they are dying off. It's just a memory. What you're doing, for better or for worse, we're grateful, because we won't be around, and I can't remember anyway. You know that. So it's,
you
thank
have a
you.
Remarkable memory.
Yeah. No.
Well, I'm sure your children and your grandchildren will find this helpful, but I would hope that generations to come will learn a lot as well.
It'll be interesting.
I have a few questions to close with then. And at first, when I approached you, you didn't want to be interviewed.
Right.
So why did you decide to be interviewed?
I was thinking of myself, but thinking of Francis, after visiting with him several times, he would always boast about his buddies that are around Chicago that went with him to the service. And I thought, you know, it was the story that someone would persevere to find us in the combat situation. Maybe you can do something with it. I couldn't. But so I thought you'd be the one.
I'd be the one to interview Francis.
Yes.
Well, thank you very much. That was a great interview.
Yeah.
And then it was just one further step to convince you to do it.
Well, you didn't have to twist my arm too hard. Yes, I'm very grateful.
After 70 years then, you kind of alluded to this already, have your views about Japan and the Japanese people continued to evolve over time?
Yes, I don't run into too many of them in Decatur, but it's like any nationality, you have to get to know them.
How do you think that experience in the Philippines has changed your outlook on life?
Oh, immensely. I don't take our time here very casually. A lot of little things. We make the most of what we have and not be a crybaby. I can remember coming home from a meeting in the school district from St. Louis, and there was a whiteout and all the trees were down on Decatur. A terrible storm, ice storm that was here. And it was Easter, or getting close to Easter, and the kids were there. We couldn't turn on the cook stove, so we turned on the fireplace, and I said, we've done this before. Let's just broil our steaks or hamburgers and put the can of beans in the fire, and we'll be fine. And up until then, they didn't know what to do. You just use what you can.
So for you, it was just no big deal, huh?
Yeah, we've been bombed before.
Well, you've gone through an awful lot in your life. Any regrets?
Oh, probably, but not seriously. You do the best you can at the time, and you don't look back.
How about the most exhilarating moment of your life?
I think when I married John. The wedding pictures will show. Yeah, I mean, I had it all.
Even more than being liberated or getting to the United States.
I didn't understand what we had given up or what we, But I understand very well what a good marriage is. And so, who knows what we'll go through.
Okay, Marianne, here's your last chance. What life's lessons, or what would you like to tell people that they should know about understanding the experiences you've had?
Well, serious thought and not so serious thought. I don't know what you would do without a God in heaven, and gratefulness that we have what we have. I believe very strongly in a free will. And this is one thing I have problems with. We've knocked the free will out of our system, of the importance of it. That those who can work, we have a free will, go to work. And we've killed that with either programs or something. But we've gotten away from our use of free will. And I think that, like my dad going on the garbage detail and this and that, nobody told him what to do.
Well, free will sounds also like initiative? Would that be another good word for it?
Yes, yes. We all have it, and we need to use it a little bit more. I can't believe how much he has always been employed. He could go to work, and I guess, and did the war teach that? Well, that's the extreme.
Well, Mary Ann, thank you very much. This has been a wonderful experience. I've learned a lot, and I'm sure anybody who listens to this will as well.
I hope. I had free will.
And you chose to do this. Thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You bet. And thank you for joining us.